Good morning and a very warm welcome to our online service from the Northern Parishes of Dartmoor. In my mini-series of Sundays with alternative titles, this one seems to take the biscuit. I was brought up knowing it as Low Sunday, and the derivation of that is a little bit unsure. It could be low as opposed to the high Sunday of Easter. Some cynical people might say it's because of the low congregations after the high numbers at Easter, but it's most probably a corruption of the Latin word laudes, meaning praise or glory. Amongst Orthodox denominations, there are a whole host of different titles for this Sunday. In some, they call it Antipascha, the opposite end of Easter, and others might call it Thomas Sunday, and we will hear the story of Thomas later. Others yet call it White, Bright, or Light Sunday, because of the white robes that people who were baptised at the Easter Vigil continue to wear for a week after the baptism. Yet more call it New Sunday, Renewal Sunday, and even Quasimodo Sunday. And that is because of the first four words in the Latin introit for the day, which are Quasimodo genitae infantes, meaning as newborn babes. And then in the year 2000, Pope John Paul II decreed that it should be known as Divine Mercy Sunday. He was to die 5 years later on the eve of Divine Mercy Sunday, and it was on this day in 2011 that Pope Benedict XVI beatified John Paul II. It is still the Easter season. And it will be the Easter season until after Ascension Day, which is May the 26th this year. And the writer Charles Kingsley, who knew Chagford and wrote Water Babies, wrote this charming poem about Easter week. See the land, her Easter keeping, rises as her maker rose. Seeds, so long in darkness sleeping, burst at last from winter snows. Earth with heaven above rejoices, fields and gardens hail the spring, shores and woodlands ring with voices while the wild birds build and sing. You, to whom your Maker granted powers to those sweet birds unknown, use the craft by God implanted, use the reason not your own. Here, while heaven and earth rejoices, each his Easter tribute bring, work of fingers, chant of voices, like the birds who build and sing. So now, after a moment of silence, let us start our worship with a prayer. Merciful God, who, by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. And so let us now have our first hymn for today.
To you again and again.
Come now to a time when we confess our sins.
Lord, like Mary at the empty tomb, we fail to grasp the wonder of your presence. Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and to confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. Call us back to your ways, O Lord, to seek hope and reconciliation, restoration and peace. In the name of the risen Christ we pray. Amen. And now we will have today's readings.
John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power for ever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty.
The Gospel reading is taken from John chapter 20, beginning at verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name.
Jesus came. and stood among his disciples. At any other place in the Gospels, this statement wouldn't appear strange. It must have occurred countless times before this particular moment. Yet this time, it's very different. Because Jesus standing in the midst of his disciples was not only unexpected, it was surely impossible. It comes as no surprise to us, sitting in our homes on the second Sunday of Easter in the year of our Lord 2022. We know the story. Jesus was supposed to be dead, and the disciples were now afraid for their own lives. Their fear wasn't unreasonable. The person in whom they had put their trust, who they had believed to be the Messiah, and who they had given everything up for to follow, was now dead. The story in which they had invested their lives appeared to be over, and they had been wrong. Even worse, they feared that they too might share the same fate as Jesus. Their persecutors were possibly prowling around outside, and they daren't go out. Sitting here in the year of our Lord 2022, our minds go straight away, don't they, to the people of Ukraine, cowering in their basements, afraid to go out. Having seen so many scenes of Ukrainians hiding in cellars and basements, it's perhaps easier for us this year than others to imagine ourselves in the place of the disciples. They had risked their lives for their beliefs, and it had all gone so horribly wrong. And as they're sitting there, wringing their hands, suddenly in the midst of them, there is Jesus. How astonished they must have been. Jesus, the one whom they believed was not only their Messiah, but also their friend, was alive and standing in their midst. How could it be? What great reversal beyond the bounds of possibility had occurred in the natural order of things? Jesus must have sensed their bewilderment. The first words he spoke to his disciples were, "Peace be with you." Words which resonate with us as down the centuries we've heard them every time we celebrate the Eucharist. Peace be with you. And also with you, we respond, or perhaps, and with thy spirit. Peace be with you. Jesus said these words on this occasion to reassure his disciples that his presence in their midst wasn't an illusion or hallucination. He really was alive. Their belief was not misplaced. The story was not over. Their hopes had been resurrected with Christ. They must have wondered what exactly this would mean for them. What will the continuation, this resurrection of their shared story, require of them? Jesus again responds to their innermost concerns by repeating, "Peace be with you." And then adding, "As the Father has sent me, so I sent you." Plainly, Jesus tells the disciples that they can't remain in the comfort and safety of the home in which they had sheltered. His story isn't over. And because of this, their story wasn't over either. This was always the plan. And the next step would require them to go out into the world and share the good news of the resurrection with everyone. I wonder if this request made them even more afraid. I wonder how you or I might have responded if we had been gathered there with them. In our modern context, sharing our faith with others can be a vulnerable thing to do. But most people we might encounter in our day-to-day lives have at least some idea of the story. And they've heard a portion of it at least before. I wonder what it might have been like to break this story, to be the first people to share the news of the resurrection with one another. The claim would surely be met by disbelief. How could it not? In fact, even one of their own didn't believe. Thomas, one of the 12 disciples, had not been present with the others when Jesus first appeared to them. While the other disciples had witnessed and come to believe in the resurrection, Thomas still had his doubts. He couldn't bring himself to believe without also seeing Jesus for himself. Thomas often gets a bad press. We who have the benefit of reading this story with a fuller knowledge of what would occur often dismiss Thomas's unbelief, assuming that we would have been less hesitant to believe or more faithful in our resistance of reasonable doubt. But is doubt a weakness? Or is it simply an opportunity, a space, a possible fertile ground in which faith might grow and ultimately blossom? Perhaps Thomas was opening to this blossoming when he said, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." And a week later, the disciples were gathered together again in the same house where they had last seen Jesus. Only this time, Thomas was with them. During the last encounter, the doors of the house were locked, but this time the doors were only shut. Perhaps this small detail offers some clue that while the disciples still wanted to be safe, they were only human after all, they had been strengthened and emboldened by their encounter with the risen Lord. Once again, Jesus came and stood in the midst of his disciples. He greeted them again, saying, "Peace be with you," before turning and addressing Thomas directly. He said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." The Greek word we translate as doubt is apistos, which means unfaithful, faithless, or unbelieving, without trust in God. Jesus is touching on something deeper here than Thomas simply doubting that the person of Jesus was no longer dead and had resurrected. Jesus was touching on Thomas's belief, or lack of belief, in the God who had sent Jesus into the world and who was capable of resurrecting not only Jesus, but the entire creation. Most of us can identify with Thomas, I think. It can be very hard to believe in new life and resurrection. It can be very hard to hope when the world around us often seems bent on its own destruction rather than resurrection and new life. But Jesus' words, "Do not doubt, but believe," are aimed not only at Thomas, but also at all those, including us, who encounter this passage and are struggling to believe that God is able to do the thing which God has done and which he has promised, to call our world into new and unending resurrected life. Thomas responds saying, "My Lord and my God." And this should be our response whenever we find ourselves in Thomas's shoes, struggling to believe and remain faithful. Jesus says to Thomas, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. That's us, isn't it? With our anxieties and our occasional doubts. We have not seen with our own eyes the resurrected Christ, but we have come to believe. We believe not because we have seen his wounds or placed our hands within his side, but because we have seen Christ in the face of others, perhaps, those who rise from the ashes of their lives, those who have been touched by Christ and live their lives in such a way that they make Christ known to us. Or perhaps we have met Christ in the words of the Bible, or the beauty of creation, or through our times of worship. We are those who are blessed because we have not seen, and yet we have come to believe. Even with all our times of doubt and pessimism, we cling on to those God moments and those examples of God-filled people. And we keep on saying, "My Lord and my God." We, just like the first disciples, seek safety and too often let fear and doubt paralyze us. But Jesus continues to stand among us, beckoning us to believe and offering us his peace. Behold, the Alpha and the Omega. The risen Christ is at work in our world. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Peace be with you. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, as we come before you now with our prayers of intercession, take from our minds the strain and stress and the busyness of our lives. Help us to focus upon you, Jesus, our victorious, risen Lord, the Prince of Peace. In John's Gospel, Jesus blessed his disciples three times with the words, "Peace be with you." We thank you, Jesus, that we can claim your risen peace and blessing for our lives as we place our trust in you. You understand, Lord, when we go through times like Thomas of doubt and unbelief. Thomas, who needed to see and feel you before he believed. Then the moment when he saw, felt and saw the risen Christ, he exclaimed, "My Lord and my God." We thank you that for each one of us who believe but have not yet seen, we have your promised blessing upon our lives and can claim you as our Lord and our God. Here is a prayer from the Celtic Daily Prayer Book. As the moorland pool images the sun, so in our hours of self-giving thou shinest on us, and we mirror thee to others. But of that other land, or heaven to be, we have no picture at all, only we know that thou art there, and Jesus the door and the welcome of each faithful one. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the people of your church in our land, its leaders and all who prayerfully follow you as your representatives. Help and strengthen our clergy in their daily duties of serving you, and may their love and commitment draw those who are seeking hope and meaning to their lives. May they be drawn by your unconditional love in discovering that you, Lord Jesus, are the answer. Jesus, we pray for those in every area of our troubled world, caught up in violence, despair, hatred, and suffering. We continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. We thank you for the bravery of all who are striving to bring aid to those in need, and we think of the news reporters and medics. Guard and protect them, Lord, with your angels, together with all refugees seeking safety from the continuing Russian bombardment. We pray for our politicians here in the UK and for all leaders and decision makers around the world, that you would guide and direct their minds and their voices with your God-given discernment and wisdom in their efforts to bring about peace and justice. Guide us too, Lord Jesus, in knowing what part, however big or small, we can play in helping to restore your peace and harmony where there is conflict. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our local community and for those known to us who are in need at this time. Let us spend a few moments as we silently name them before you. Lord Jesus, we thank you that all are known to you who are suffering, either through abuse, loneliness, despair, hardship, or bereavement. Help us to be willing instruments of your peace and love in coming alongside those in need, whether it be to help practically or to be a listening ear. We pray for our local schools, for the safety and well-being of our children, for teachers, assistants, and all who provide care in nurturing our young people. We think of families and individuals who are struggling with the escalating cost of living in these challenging times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, a prayer for ourselves from the words of the prophet Jeremiah. The blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. He will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when the heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. Lord Jesus, help us to serve you by placing our trust and our confidence in your life-giving stream. Like the tree whose roots are fed and nourished, may our roots of faith deepen and grow and spread by remaining in you always. Help us not to fear when trouble comes, but to believe that you are always with us, whatever we may go through. You are alive. You have risen. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now let us bring our intercessions together with the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Kind for all your goodness.
chorus I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find to bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
As we heard, St. Thomas had to see to believe. He had human weaknesses, and perhaps we might all have felt the same as him. He teaches us that we must trust in our faith and that we pray that we are given the strength to believe in what is right without having to have proof. These words were found written on the cell wall of a Jewish prisoner in a Nazi concentration camp. I believe in the sun, even when it's not shining. I believe in love, even when I cannot feel it. I believe in God, even when He is silent. I believe through any trial, there is always a way. May there someday be sunshine. May there someday be happiness. May there someday be love. May there someday be peace. Jesus stood among them and said, "Peace be with you, as the Father has sent me, so I send you." So let us go out and do the Father's work in the name of the Son and in the strength of the Spirit. Amen. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Do stay safe this week, and we hope that you will join us again very soon. Goodbye.